Thank you all. That was an attempt to chronicle the journey of yoga from the Indian context right till the very moment. Before we invite our official dignitaries onto the stage, we would seek your attention for this very special video message from the very same person who initiated this idea in the United Nations General Assembly last year, the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi ji's message. Can we have that message please on the screen?
पूरा विश्व 21 जून अंतर्राष्ट्रीय योगा दिवस के लिए प्रतिबद्ध हैं, कटिबद्ध हैं, प्रयत्नरत है। भारत इस बात के लिए गर्व अनुभव करता है कि यूएनओ ने इस विषय को आगे बढ़ाया। दुनिया के 177 कंट्रीज ने उसको को-स्पॉन्सर किया और भारत की अनमोल विरासत आज विश्व की अनमोल विरासत बनी है। ये अहम को वयम के साथ जोड़ने का प्रयास है, ये स्व को समष्टि के साथ जोड़ने का प्रयास है, जड़ चेतन में एकत्व की अनुभूति कराने का प्रयास है। और इसलिए आज जो विश्व अकेलेपन की ओर बढ़ रहा है, परिवार में भी हर व्यक्ति अलग है, भीड़ में भी हम अपने आप को अकेला महसूस करते हैं, दुनिया के अंदर भी हर देश अपने आप को अकेला महसूस करता है, ये अवस्था कल्याणकारी नहीं है। प्रकृति दत्त व्यवस्था है जुड़ना, जड़ चेतन से साथ जुड़ना, और उसके लिए योग एक माध्यम है। हम प्रकृति से कैसे जुड़े, अपनों से कैसे जुड़े, अपनेपन से कैसे जुड़े, मेरे भीतर जो कुछ भी है उससे मैं कैसे जुड़ूं, समाज अवस्था में चारों तरफ तनाव दिखाई दे रहा है। क्या तनाव से मुक्ति का कोई मार्ग ही नहीं हो सकता है? अगर स्थायी भाव से तनाव मुक्ति चाहिए तो अंतर मन में स्थिरता चाहिए। अंतर मन की स्थिरता का अवसर आता है योग साधना से। प्रतिदिन निश्चित समय हम अपने भीतर जाने के लिए लगा देंगे और योग के जो रास्ते हैं उससे सरलता से किया जा सकता है। मुझे विश्वास है कि अंतर्राष्ट्रीय योगा दिवस के द्वारा विश्व जो तनाव के संकट से गुजर रहा है, व्यक्ति जो तनाव महसूस करता है, व्यक्ति जो अपनी समस्याओं को अगल बगल में भी शेयर कर नहीं पा रहा है, वो खुद के साथ अपने आप को जोड़ करके अपने तनावों को मुक्त करने का सामर्थ्य प्राप्त कर सकता है। और आखिरकार व्यक्ति तनाव मुक्त होगा तो समाज भी तनाव मुक्त बनेगा, समाज तनाव मुक्त बना तो पूरा मानव जात तनाव मुक्त बन सकती है, और मानव जात तनाव मुक्त हो तो फिर पूरा विश्व सुख शांति और सौहार्द के वातावरण से पुलकित हो उठ सकता है। तो एक बड़े सपने को लेकर के छोटा सा आरंभ योग से होता है, और मैं पूरे विश्व समुदाय का योगा दिवस को समर्थन करने के लिए हृदय से अभिनंदन करता हूँ, और मैं आपसे प्रार्थना करता हूँ ये प्रयास आपकी जिंदगी को तनाव मुक्त बनाए, आपके जीवन को खुशियों से भर दें, आप भी वर्तमान में जीना सीखें, आप भी खुद के शक्ति और सामर्थ्य को पहचानें, अपने भीतर की शक्तियों को और अधिक शक्तिशाली बनाने के रास्ते को प्राप्त करें। आप देखिए, अगर आपका भला हुआ तो दुनिया का भला अपने आप उसमें समाहित है। आपसे शुरू करने का काम है ये योगा, और आज विश्व ने इसको स्वीकार किया है। जो प्रिवेंटिव हेल्थ केयर को विश्वास करते हैं उनके लिए भी उपयोगी है, जो होलिस्टिक हेल्थ केयर में विश्वास करते हैं ये उनके लिए भी उपयोगी है। और जब आज की युवा पीढ़ी जहाँ हिंसा की ओर चली जाती है, जहाँ आत्महत्या की ओर चली जाती है, जहाँ डिप्रेशन की जिंदगी भी जीती है, उनको बचाने के लिए मैं समझता हूँ योगा सबसे सरल मार्ग है। आइए हम सब मिलकर के मानव कल्याण के लिए उपयोगी इस एक महान शास्त्र के साथ जुड़े, महान विरासत के साथ जुड़े, और ये विरासत मानव की विरासत है, विश्व की विरासत है, ये विरासत आपकी विरासत है, और ये आपका दायित्व है कि आने वाली पीढ़ियों को उत्तम तरीके से ये विरासत हम सुपुर्द करें, और इसके लिए हम आज अपने आप को सज्ज करें। मेरी अंतर्राष्ट्रीय योगा दिवस के लिए आपको बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं हैं।
With that message from the Honorable Prime Minister of India, may I now take this opportunity to introduce our distinguished dignitaries and request them to kindly join us on stage for this first segment, please. I am honored to invite on stage the Honorable External Affairs Minister of India, Srimati Sushma Swaraj ji. His Excellency, the President of the United Nations 69th General Assembly, His Sam Kutte sir. His Excellency, the Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Ban Ki-moon. Our special guest of honor, Congresswoman all the way from Hawaii, Representative Tulsi Gabbard. And our host for today, Permanent Representative of India to the United Nations, Ambassador Ashok Mukherjee, to kindly deliver the welcome remarks and join us on stage.
Honorable President of the United Nations General Assembly, Mr. Sam Kutesa, and Madam Jennifer Kutesa, Honorable External Affairs Minister of India, Srimati Sushma Swaraj, Honorable Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Ban Ki-moon and Madam Ban, Honorable Congresswoman Tulsi Gabbard and Mr. Abraham Williams, respected Guruji Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, distinguished dignitaries, excellencies, friends, yoga-loving community at the United Nations, Namaste. Today is indeed unique. It is unique because what is happening today on a Sunday morning at the United Nations has perhaps never happened before. We have amidst us in the galaxy, amidst us a galaxy of yoga lovers from all walks of life, both the initiated as well as the completely uninitiated. It is historic because what we are about to witness today is being watched live, not just in the United Nations, but in India and an audience of thousands across the world. Today, the United Nations is synergizing its activity with New York City in partnership with the Times Square Alliance in a very unique public interface using the power of modern communications technology to convey the significance of the contribution of yoga to global health and awareness. We recognize the vision of the Honorable Prime Minister of India, who addressed us a brief while ago. The outpouring of support for his vision in the General Assembly resolution, which was adopted unanimously with 177 co-sponsoring countries on the 11th of December 2014, demonstrates that the International Day of Yoga is indeed an idea whose time has come. Today, when we witness the first celebration of the United Nations International Day of Yoga, with nearly 2 billion people across the globe joining in at 256 cities in 192 countries, we are witnessing a most unique celebration of the human spirit being reaffirmed in an unprecedented global embrace, the union of the body, mind, and soul through the practice of yoga. On behalf of the Permanent Mission of India to the United Nations, I welcome all of you to today's celebrations. I would draw your attention to the Sanskrit slok that you saw in the opening video, which so aptly epitomizes the values that India, as one of the founder members of the United Nations, seeks to revive globally through the International Day of Yoga initiative. The slok is Om Sarve Bhuvantu Sukhina, or let there be happiness, may all be free from illness, may all see what is good, may no one suffer, may all have good health, and let there be peace. Peace and peace. Namaste.
Thank you, Excellency. May I now invite Honorable External Affairs Minister of India, Honorable Sushma Swaraj, to kindly deliver the presiding address.
His Holiness, the respected Yoga Guru, Sri Sri Ravi Shankarji, who will take over this stage after the segment of this event, Your Excellency, Mr. Sam Kutesa, President of the General Assembly, Your Excellency, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, Secretary General of the United Nations, Acharya Lokesh Muni, who is sitting amongst us, Excellencies, Ambassadors, my friend, who has specially come for this occasion, Ms. Tulsi Gabbard, distinguished guests and friends. It's a singular honor for me to join all of you today to celebrate the first International Day of Yoga. Friends, it is not often that both occasion and location match each other in scale. Here in this historic place that was built to protect succeeding generations from the scourge of war, we gather to celebrate an ancient treasure, India's own gift to the world. Yoga began in India some 5,000 years ago, but it was given the ultimate seal of international acclaim only last year by the United Nations. And this is the place where it all began, when on the 27th of September 2014, Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, first made the proposal in the UN General Assembly to have an International Day of Yoga. I should first and foremost thank all the 192 member states for their full support, which allowed our resolution declaring 21 June as the International Day of Yoga to be adopted by consensus. In particular, I thank the 176 member states besides India, who by co-sponsoring the resolution took equal ownership of the initiative. The resolution was adopted with 75 days of Prime Minister Modi's proposing. It bears an evidence to the fact that it was an idea whose time had come. I must also record my gratitude to Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, who provided immediate and unstinted support to our proposal, and to the President of the General Assembly, Foreign Minister Sam Kutesa, for the leadership he provided on this issue. In a world increasingly divided by what the great poet Rabindranath Tagore called narrow domestic walls. Prime Minister Modi had a vision of India's ancient treasure that would do the opposite, that would, through the notion of holistic health and a conscious search for the self, seek to bring us all together. Yoga literally means to join, to unite, and we see the International Day of Yoga as the perfect platform to bring the world together in a spirit of unity and harmony. Yoga is neither a religion, nor should it be seen as belonging to any particular religion. It is a science, the science of well-being, the science of integrating body, mind, and soul, and the science of actualizing our true potential. Even as I speak, tens of thousands of New Yorkers are practicing yoga just over a mile away at Times Square. Millions others all across the world in 192 nations have joined them in their own unique national celebrations on this historic day. In my own country, India, Prime Minister Modi led the largest yoga class in history, where he addressed more than 35,000 people at Rajpath a few hours ago. This truly is a confirmation of the international character of yoga as well as its convening power. By celebrating the International Day of Yoga together, we celebrate our common humanity. We are recognizing that we have shared opportunities. We are also acknowledging our sense of a shared global fate. Prime Minister Narendra Modi, in his address to the General Assembly last year, had said that yoga embodies unity of mind and body, thought and action, restraint and fulfillment, and harmony between man and nature. The United Nations is about nations living in harmony with each other. By celebrating the International Day of Yoga at the United Nations, I believe we send a powerful message about men and women living in harmony with each other and also in harmony with nature. At a time when ethnic conflicts and extremist violence are threatening to destabilize societies, yoga can serve as the perfect antidote to stem such negative tendencies and move us on the path of harmony and peace. I'm confident that yoga can also become a potent tool for the United Nations to promote the message of brotherhood and amity in the finest Indian tradition of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. The entire world is one family, and we can unite it with yoga. Yoga Guru B.K. Iyengar used to say, when you inhale, you are taking the strength from God. When you exhale, it represents the service you are giving to the world. On this first International Day of Yoga, let us join our breaths. Let us combine our strengths for a safer, happier, and healthier world. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you, Madam, for your invitation, motivational words. May I now invite His Excellency, President of the 69th UN General Assembly, Mr. Sam Kutesa, to kindly deliver his address, please. Sir, you have the floor.
Your Excellency, Sushma Swaraj, Minister of External Affairs of India, Your Excellencies, Your Excellency Ban Ki-moon, Secretary General of the United Nations, Congresswoman, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and a happy Yoga Day. It is inspiring to see such a large gathering as we commemorate this International Yoga Day. The diversity of participants here today is reflective of the widespread interest in yoga around the world, which appeals to people from all walks of life. Today's celebration is the result of Resolution 69/131, adopted by the General Assembly on 11th December, declaring the 21st of June each year as the year of International Yoga Day, as the day of International Yoga Day. the resolution initiated by a delegation of India was exceptional, given the resounding support it received, having been unanimously adopted by consensus with 177 co-sponsoring member states. Excellencies, over the years, the international community has recognized the importance of a healthy population to socio-economic development. Increasingly, the issue of global health has taken broader dimensions. We not only have to be healthy in body, but also in mind. It is therefore befitting that today's first celebration of the International Day of Yoga is taking place in many cities around the world, including at Times Square, right here in our host city of New York. It is estimated that almost one-third of humanity will be participating in celebrating this century's old tradition and practice around the world today, which is a true testament to its popularity. For centuries, people have practiced yoga, recognized its unique embodiment of unity between mind and body. The benefits of practicing yoga are well known, including stress relief, the improvement of focus and awareness, as well as the promotion of overall peace of mind. In practice, yoga also encourages selflessness, service, and compassion, all of which are important values of humanity. I thank you all for having invited me to participate in this historic ceremony, and I want to thank you all for your kind attention, and have a great yoga day. Thank you.
Thank you, Excellency, for your inspiring address. And before we invite our keynote speaker for today, allow me to request a picture from his last visit to India to be brought up on the screen, please. Can we have that picture quickly? This is the image. This is the image that went viral on social media when the CEO of the United Nations, His Excellency, the Secretary General, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, performed the famous tree asana, which also became then the most trending picture on Twitter. So given that he has already been initiated into the yoga fold, may I have the honor to now invite His Excellency, Secretary General Mr. Ban Ki-moon, to kindly deliver the keynote address.
Your Excellency, Mr. Sam Kutesa, President of the General Assembly, Your Excellency, Srimati Sushma Swaraj, Minister of External Affairs of the Republic of India, Your Excellency Ambassador Ashok Kumar Mukherjee, Permanent Representative of India to United Nations, Honorable Tulsi Gabbard, Member of Congress, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, Yoga Guru and the founder of Art of Living Foundation, Excellencies, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to welcome all of you here today. Welcome also to those joining our celebration over the Times Square in India and across the world via webcast, and to those watching live on Periscope. I also welcome Mr. Tim Tompkins, President of the Times Square Alliance, and Yoga Guru Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. To all of you, I say Namaste. This is the first year that we observe International Day of Yoga, proclaimed by the United Nations General Assembly. This is a wonderful addition to the United Nations calendar. I commend His Excellency Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the government of India for taking this initiative to spread the practice of yoga far and wide across the world. Of course, yoga is already immensely popular around the world. It's good for your health. It's good for the spirit. And yoga does not discriminate. To varying degrees, all people can practice regardless of their strength, age, or ability. During a visit to India earlier this year, as you have already seen, I tried my first asana, the tree pose. I really felt like I was out on a limb. But once I regained my balance, I began to feel a certain peace of mind. I'm hoping that if yoga promotes physical dexterity, it can also promote diplomatic dexterity. In my job as Secretary General of the United Nations, I have to be agile all of the times. As we celebrate this new International Day of Yoga, let us recall a few words from His Excellency Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who told the UN General Assembly that, I quote, "Yoga is not just about exercise. It is a way to discover the sense of oneness with yourself, the world, and nature," end of quote. My hope is that yoga will give people everywhere the sense and the oneness we need to work together to live in harmony and usher in a life of dignity for all. In that spirit, I say again, namaste, dhanyawad, I thank you.
Thank you so much, Excellency, for honoring us with your profound words and your personal experience. I have the honor now to invite a very special guest who only 2 days ago introduced a congressional resolution on the Yoga Day. From all the way from Hawaii, who has served with distinction also as a soldier in Iraq, and as per her CV, is a proud first Hindu to ever serve as a member of the US Congress, our guest of honor for today, Representative Tulsi Gabbard.
Respected leaders, honored guests, namaste and aloha. As individuals and as a society, in order to have peace and happiness, we need wisdom and spiritual love. 3 days ago, a man walked into a church in South Carolina and in cold blood gunned down 9 people. Why? Because of ignorance and hate. For too long, the world has witnessed the brutal terrorism of groups like ISIS. Why do such groups exist? Because of ignorance and hate. There's so much suffering caused by this ignorance and hate. It points to our individual and societal need for the light of wisdom and spiritual love. In my view, this is why the world needs yoga so much. Improvements to physical health and the many other benefits of yoga are universally appreciated. But the greatest gifts of yoga, this wisdom and spiritual love, are even more important. According to yoga, perfect wisdom and spiritual love exists within each and every one of us. But this wisdom and love is covered and lies dormant. However, through the yoga of the Bhagavad Gita, this innate wisdom and spiritual love can be uncovered and cultivated. The result of removing the darkness and hate from our hearts will be happier and more peaceful individuals and a more peaceful and harmonious society and world. Understanding this truth is the path to peace. Mahatma Gandhi said, "There must be recognition of the existence of the soul apart from the body, and of its permanent nature, and this recognition must amount to a living faith. And in the last resort, nonviolence does not avail those who do not possess a living faith in the God of love. In both Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, as well as the ancient yoga scripture, Bhagavad Gita, we learn that we are not this physical body. Rather, we are spiritual in essence, part and parcel of the Supreme Soul. Falsely identifying ourselves as these material bodies and their different colors and ethnicities creates barriers and animosities between us. If we think I am brown, he is white, she is black, we're failing to appreciate that we are truly the soul within the body, and that we're all equal and related as children of God, regardless of any external differences. It is ignorance of this truth and the hatred born of that ignorance that is the root cause of racism, violence, terrorism, and religious bigotry that we unfortunately witness here at home and around the world. A true yogi understands that we are not these physical bodies. We are, in fact, all spiritual beings, united by our common kinship with the Supreme Soul. The wisdom and spiritual love that we find in yoga will bear the fruit of mutual respect for others, regardless of their race, nationality, religion, or any other differences. So, on this International Day of Yoga, let us all be inspired to dive into the deeper aspects of yoga, where we can each discover the treasure of wisdom, spiritual love, and peace that yoga has to offer us all. Jai Shri Krishna. Namaste. Aloha.
Thank you, Representative Gebhardt, for your highly motivational and inspirational words. I would now like to invite our last distinguished speaker from this segment. He is responsible for having initiated in Times Square the love for yoga way back in 2003. He started with just three people, I'm told then. His passion for yoga led him to become a certified yoga instructor and create a yoga fan following that has made the Times Square Solstice Day event with more than 30,000 followers now. Please welcome Mr. Tim Topkins, the president of the Times Square Alliance, to the podium, please.
Distinguished officials and honored guests, thank you for all these amazing words. Thank you, Congresswoman, for that amazing speech and for all that has been said. When we had our first summer solstice yoga celebration in Times Square 13 years ago, as a counterpoint to our a little bit more noisy and crazy winter solstice celebration, also known as New Year's Eve in Times Square, there were only three people, myself, Douglas Stewart, who's the co-founder of this event, and who was one of my first yoga teachers and a guru to me, who inspired me to pick up yoga and also to become a certified teacher, and one other student. This year, over 15,000 people pre-registered within a number of days, and then we had to close down pre-registration. The reason for that, of course, is what we are celebrating here today, which is the power of yoga. The idea was simple: finding health, peace, and commitment and contentment, santosa, in a beautiful and serene natural environment is one thing. As we said in our initial statement, Times Square Yoga, Mind Over Madness, we said almost anyone can eventually find peace of mind in a beautiful mountaintop, but try finding it in the middle of Times Square. The challenge, of course, it's a metaphor for the challenge we all face. The challenge for those of us who choose to engage with the world, and no organization chooses to engage with the world and its problems more than the United Nations, is how to find that sense of peace in today's frenetic, intense, and chaotic world a world so often governed by fear or greed or a desire for mere material things. And of course, if nothing else, Times Square represents the crazy pace and the many distractions of the modern world. And so we chose to have this metaphor of stillness amidst all the madness. And we also chose the day of the summer solstice, a day where for us in New York and the Northern Hemisphere, the sun, the source of all natural energy, shines longest and brightest as a way of reminding ourselves in the midst of this human-made environment of the larger rhythms and power of life and nature. I cannot express how wonderful it is that the government of India, a country that has brought so much joy and beauty and wisdom to the world, as well as the United Nations, an institution which was founded to promote health and peace around the world, have worked together to create the International Day of Yoga on the day of the summer solstice. With more chaos than ever in the world, which we've heard about today, whether it's 60 million refugees to the racial hatred and violence in our country at home in the United States, it is not a moment too soon to celebrate yoga as a tool not only for personal health and peace, but for, as a tool for health and peace throughout the world. So thank you, India, for the gift of yoga, and thank you. Yes. And thank you, the United Nations and all its member countries, 177 countries that voted for this, for celebrating that gift, which we now are celebrating.
Thank you, Mr. Topkins. Distinguished guests, yoga, as the great guru BKS Iyengar had said, is like music. The rhythm of the body, the melody of the mind, and the harmony of the soul that create the symphonies of life. And now that the part of speeches is over, may we now move over to the real yoga stuff, as they say. Introducing our revered and respected guru, and perhaps the star of the day, globally revered and with a following of millions, Sri Sri Ravishankar Ji is known to the world as a humanitarian leader, spiritual leader, and ambassador of peace. Having founded the Art of Living program, he has rekindled the traditions of yoga and meditation and offered them a form that is relevant to the 21st century. And as we shift the scenario on the stage, may I invite respected Sri Sri Ji to please join the dignitaries for a group photograph before we commence the yoga session. Please, a warm applause, a loud applause for Sri Sri Ravishankar Ji. May I also invite Mr. Tim Topkins, Madam Ban, Madam Kutesa, Madam Mukherjee, and the Undersecretary General, Chef de Cabinet, Madam Susanna Malkora, also on the stage for this group picture, please. Sir. Can I also invite our distinguished Acharya Lokesh Muneji on stage, please? Can we have a warm applause again for all the dignitaries, please? While all the dignitaries move to their respective chairs, I would request Sri Sri Ji to please stay on the front of the stage and commence the proceedings, please. And as we do this, and we change to the next segment, I would like to play a short introductory video on yoga from the Art of Living. Can we have that audio visual, please?
In the beginning, there was darkness, and darkness was covered with darkness. Then came the light with a sound. And Om gave rise to words or knowledge, which got compiled as the Vedas. In the hierarchy of Vedic knowledge, there are four Vedas: Rig Veda, Samaveda, Yajurveda, and Atharvaveda. Then comes four Upvedas, or Subvedas, six Upangas, or components, and then six subcomponents, out of which one is Yoga. There are several types of Yoga as well, like Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, Hatha Yoga, Raj Yoga, Mantra Yoga, Shiva Yoga, Nada Yoga, Laya Yoga, and many more. Rig Veda is one of the most sacred and the oldest books of human history. It is about 8 to 10,000 years old, and Yoga is a part of this Vedic literature. Maharishi Patanjali, considered to be the authority on Yoga, propounded Yoga nearly 5,000 years ago. Lord Krishna and many saints of India have also spoken about Yoga. In the Middle Ages, the practice of Yoga was confined only to the royal and the scholarly class. It was taught to students in Gurukuls after passing a rigorous test. In the recent years, by the effort of many spiritual and religious leaders of India, the doors of Yoga have been opened to the common man and to each and every human being on this planet. Yoga is the union of body, mind, and spirit, the individual to the universal. Yoga is realizing the connection between the finite and the infinite, the manifest and the unmanifest. Yoga is bringing harmony in thought, word, and deed. Maharishi Patanjali elucidated eight limbs of yoga, namely Yama, social ethics, Niyama, personal ethics, Asana, postures, Pranayama, directing the life force, Pratyahara, turning the
I think we had a small problem with the audiovisual there. While we fix it up, I would request the first row of the audience to please have a look back and recognize that Secretary General Ban Ki-moon and Madam Ban Ki-moon have joined us on the yoga mats now to perform in this session. Thank you, sir, for joining us in this yoga segment. May I now give the podium to Revered Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ji. Sir, you have to.
Let me first thank the dignitaries here who have expressed what has been the call or heartbeat of yoga advent all over the world. Your Excellencies, dignitaries, this day is very important for people who have been practicing yoga and who have found that inner peace that it needs to reach out to people more and more. In education sector, it can help our young children for a stress-free mind. Every child in this planet is entitled to a violence-free society. And yoga can provide us that. A violence-free society disease-free body, stress-free mind, inhibition-free intellect, trauma-free memory, and sorrow-free soul is the birthright of every child, every individual. And yoga is a means. I thank our Honorable Prime Minister of India for initiating this. And I also thank Honorable Secretary General Ban Ki-moon Ji of United Nations, who has helped us through to move through and declare this International Day of Yoga. No, yoga is something that brings both contentment and commitment, compassion and cordiality. Lack of these values has caused such trouble in the world. We have peacekeepers all over the world, but they themselves have to find peace first. So many of the peacekeepers lack peace, and they are in depression, stress. Yoga is a way to find that inner peace. World peace through inner peace is the language of yoga. And so it could be a very powerful tool for bringing much needed transformation in society. So let's begin today with a short prayer where, you know, we pray for Almighty to give us strength and help us move together. This is an ancient Rigvedic hymn which we will sing, which has been sung all over the world today. So we will also start with that, and then we will go through some simple yogic postures, then go into meditation. As we said, you know, yoga is not just physical exercise. It's a holistic science of human development. Developing the full potential of human being is possible through this science. So it challenges the scientists to come and do more research on it, while it invites artists to cherish its ancientness with its ever new life energy that it brings up in creativity and productivity in society. So let's start with this prayer. Om Sangachadvam Samvadadvam Samvomanansi Janatam Deva Bhagam Yatha Purve Sanjanana Upasate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Read the meaning.
We'll start with some loosening practices.
We'll read the meaning of the sloka, yes. And then we'll start the loosening practice.
The prayer, the meaning of the prayer is, may you move in harmony. May you speak in unison. Let our mind be equanimous like in the beginning. Let the divinity manifest in your sacred endeavors.
Okay, so now let's stand up. What we're going to do is loosen up our neck, you know. Just do a simple neck roll.
Let's stand with our feet comfortably apart. Let's keep our hands beside the body.
A gentle movement. You cannot move very fast. Slowly, inch by inch, feeling the stretch on one side of the neck and contraction on the other side of the neck. We roll our neck clockwise, 3 times. Gently roll, and then anti-clockwise. In yoga, whatever we do, we have to undo that. So if you move clockwise, you have to do anti-clockwise as well. Done? We're finished. Let's take a deep breath in and breathe out. We'll synchronize every moment with breath. Yoga is that synchronism with body, rhythm of body, breath, and mind. Okay, now let's place our hands on our trunk. And again, roll, gently roll our neck. Okay, then now trunk movement. This is done. Now,
let's keep the legs about 2 to 3 feet apart. Rise both the arms to the chest level with the palms facing each other and keep them parallel. While exhaling, twist the body towards the left side so that the right palm touches the left shoulder. Come back with inhalation. While exhaling, twist the body towards the right side so that the left palm touches the right shoulder. Come back with inhalation. Let's do this a couple of more times.
Main thing is loosen up your upper body.
Relax. The next movement is for the knees. Let's inhale. Lift your arms up to the shoulder level, palms facing outward. Exhale. Bend the knees and bring your body down to the squatting position.
Imagine you're sitting in the chair. And keep a smile on your face. You know, yoga is to bring humility and humor together. So you can't be too serious doing yoga. Should have a smile, yes.
Relax.
And that's it. Now yoga is all about balance. What you do is hold your hands like this, above your head, turn upward, and try to be on your toes. The world keeps you on your toes, so does yoga. Be on your toes, yeah. And then as you exhale, slowly come down and bring your hands onto your head. And once again, as you breathe in, and lift up your body, stretch your spine, stretch your body all the way up, and standing on your toes, balance, and slowly come down as you breathe out, and relax. And you can just shake your hands if it's a little tense here and there.
We'll now do the vrikshasana, or the tree posture, that you saw the picture of the Honorable Secretary General doing. Let's stand with our feet 2 inches apart. Focus on a point in front of you. Exhale, bend the right leg and place the foot on the inside of the left thigh. The heel should be touching the perineum. Inhale and extend the arms up and join the palms. Let's stay in this position for a few more seconds and breathe normally. Exhale and bring the arms and right foot down. Relax.
And you have to do it with the other feet also. Put the other feet into the inside of your thigh and go like. Yeah. And do it only as much as you can. and then come down.
We'll now do the Padahastasana. Let's stand straight with our feet about 2 inches apart. Inhale slowly and raise the arms up. Stretch the body up from the waist. Exhale and bend forward until the trunk is parallel to the ground. Exhale.
And then come down. And do only as much as you feel comfortable. Just little more than your comfort zone. That's all we need to do. Don't rest too much and then you will have all muscle pulling in the back and front. No. You have to do it only as much as you can, comfortably, with a smile, synchronizing it with the breath. This is very important. Every move we do should be like a dance, like, you know, with the rhythm, with all awareness.
Yeah. Exhale and slowly return to the starting position in reverse order. Relax with your hands by your side. We'll then do the Ardha Chakrasana. Support
your back with your palms. I'm holding the mic, so I'm showing only with one hand. You look at the people who are doing. And then bend backwards. You know, as I said, we do forward bending. We had to do balance it with backward bending. This can take care of a lot of back problems that we might be having. Or we might encounter in the future. It can arrest them even before they come. Yeah. And come back, exhaling. And then now Trikonasana. You know, as a baby, we have done all these asanas, all these postures. If you observe a baby from the age of 3 months to 3 years, it would have done all these postures. Now we'll do Trikonasana.
Let's stand with our feet comfortably apart. Slowly raise both arms sideways until they're horizontal. Exhale, bend slowly to the right side and place the right hand just behind the right foot. The left arm is straight up in line with the right arm. Turn the left palm forward. Turn your head and gaze up at the tip of the left middle finger.
Look up. Look up to the upstretched hand. Look up the sky. See, when nature supports you when you do yoga, huh? It's a sunny day. Yeah. Come back.
And we'll do this for the other side as well.
Yeah. Whatever you do on the left, you have to be on the right also. You have to do it on the right.
Raise up your right arm and bring your left palm down and look up to the sky.
And come back.
And then sit down.
Now sitting. We did so all this standing. We have 3 sets of asanas. Huh? One is standing, then sitting, and then lying down. The 3 sets we'll do quickly, little bit of all 3. Okay? You're all ready for it? Everyone? Yeah? Okay, great.
Let's sit erect with the legs stretched out straight in front. Keep the hands beside the hips. This is Dandasana. Now put your soles of the feet together. Exhale and clasp your hands together over your toes. Pull your heels as close as possible to the perineum region. If your thighs are not touching or are not close to the floor, just relax at the position that you are.
Yeah, it's like butterfly, right? Kids love butterfly. You can move your thighs a little bit like that butterfly. It loosens up all these joints, yeah? The hip joints. Okay.
Let's come to Vajrasana.
Huh.
Or diamond pose.
Vajra means strong. A posture in which when you sit, you become really strong. Vajrasana.
Let's bring our hands onto the knees. The head and back are straight. We'll stand on our knees and place the hands on the waist with our fingers pointing downward. Let's keep our elbows and shoulders parallel. Bend the head back and stretch the neck muscles.